Amen. All right, Revelation 22. We've been looking at heaven for the last few weeks. Revelation 21 starts off with a glimpse of heaven, gives us a little more detail in Revelation 21, where we have the measurements of the city, and we start looking at the walls and the precious stones. And Hugh and I were talking this morning where it's talking about the city, and last week I mentioned that the wall of the city was 244 feet thick, I think is what we said on it, and it's measured in cubits, and we translate that. And he said, well, is it the height or is it the width? And we looked at some things, and it could be either. And you imagine how big this wall is. Let's say it's 200 feet thick, then that's massive. If it's 200 feet high, it's massive. And then you start looking at, okay, we got the gates of pearl, and the gates are never closed, and there's no night. You know, why do we need a wall this thick or this high? And the gates are never closed. There's peace in this city, but there's safety in it. There's safety in Christ. And so as we look at it, looking at this magnificent New Jerusalem, it is amazing. And we're gonna get another glimpse of it, some things that are there. We already know in Revelation 21 some things that are not there. There's no death, there's no sin, there's no pain, there's no sorrow, there's no condemnation. There's a lot of things that are not in heaven that make heaven great. And then the thing that makes heaven great is that Jesus is there, that we get to spend eternity with him. And so as we get another glimpse of heaven today, we're going to come through this last chapter and see what it is that God has for us in describing this city. And there are some things here that I think will be a blessing to you and should be an encouragement to us as we look forward. You look around like Solomon did in Ecclesiastes, or you look within, you find disappointment, you find sin everywhere. It's a discouraging thing. And you get halfway through Ecclesiastes, you come into the second half of it, and Solomon begins to look up. He begins to look to his Creator, and it changes his viewpoint. And so as we look up, as we look at heaven, as we look at New Jerusalem, we look at eternity, this is something that I hope will be an encouragement to you. You look around and go, I don't know how we're going to make it. This is just not happening, and oh my. And we look at heaven and we say, yes, there is hope. That there is eternity, something to look forward to in that. And so we're going to look at three things, three aspects this morning of heaven that I think will be a blessing to you. The first one is a river of life. And so we've got the river that flows in heaven. Let's look at verse 1 of chapter 22. It says, and he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. So we have this river that is pure, that is clean, that is absolutely clear, crystal clear. Now, I know there are waters in our world that if you get into the Caribbean or you get into some of the tropical locations that you can go way out, even on some of our shoreline here that we have, that you can go a good distance and look down and see the bottom, that the river or the ocean or the water is just so clear, you can see straight whatever swimming around you. Sometimes that's frightening, what's swimming around you, of things that are in the water, and you would just see this pure, clear water that's there. And then you've been in some water where you don't know what's below you. You've been in some rivers that you go, I'm kind of unsure what's in there. They would always warn us in the Sacramento River that there was the American and the Sacramento River that kind of went around both sides of downtown. And they say, be careful in the rivers, because you don't know what's under the water, because it wasn't clear. You couldn't see through it. They say there's logs under there. There's undertow that comes in. There's different sea life that's in the water that is going to be there that makes it dangerous. And that was their clear thing, was just be careful of the flow of the water. Be careful of the undertow. Be careful of the things that are in the water. Remember Naaman when he is told to go dip in the river there, and he says, well, couldn't I go to a better river? Do I have to go to that dirty one? I have to dip in that one? Nobody wants to go in that one. You go into India and you see some of the rivers that they have there where the animals are upstream and they are in the water, and their uncleanness and everything else that happens with animals that flows down the river, where you also see people washing their clothes and bathing themselves, and you start looking at it going, not on your life. You know, that ain't happening. I'll go home and take a shower. It's going to be fine. That's what they do, and that's with the disease comes. This river here, this river is clean. It is clear. It is pure. It is perfect. And so as we look at it, look at the source of the river. The river flows from the throne of God. We've looked at the throne room of God in Revelation chapter 4. We see it in Isaiah chapter 6. We get glimpses of the throne room of God, but from this throne flows this river. And so if we have holiness, we have pureness, we have perfectness in Christ, this river flows from that. It's by the mercies of God that we have the opportunity to enter into heaven. Man in himself is unworthy. Man in himself is defiled, but we stand before God righteous, pure, holy, undefiled with this perfect river. God has made provision for us through the water of life. You look back to Jesus when he's talking to the woman at the well, where he says, I'm going to give you living water. And if you drink of this water, you'll never thirst again. Now wouldn't you like to get some of that water on a hot day? Some of that water that if you drink it, you would just never thirst again. There are times this summer and times this, what we call fall, I get a drink of water and go, that was great. I want more because I'm still thirsty. Or wake up in the morning and go, I'm still thirsty. The other night, I got several cramps in my legs and I went, I probably didn't get enough water the day before. I need to make sure I drink more water today because I'm just so thirsty for it and I've got to have it. And this water that Christ gives is the water that will make never thirst again. Now, think of the beauty of the water. Think of the clearness of it, the purity that's in it. There's nothing that flows down the river that you go, okay, contaminant, we got to be careful. There's nothing in this water that would bring that whatsoever. So it isn't hard to recognize somebody who's new to a city. Okay? That someone who's visiting maybe a large city. Someone comes to New York City. How do we tell who they are? Well, they're gazing just in awe. Okay, I'm in Times Square and here is this amazing thing. It's 11 o'clock at night, looks like daylight, you know, because of all the billboards and everything else. And you're walking around and you see this and you're taking pictures and you're doing all of this. You know, the natural people, you know, that were there to begin with, the people who live there, they're just walking around the city. They don't care anymore. But you can tell the tourists, you can tell the new people. Can you imagine what it's going to be like the first day in heaven? Walking around, noticing the tree of life or the river of life or the golden streets, just in awe. I'm going to pull out my cell phone. I'm going to take pictures of heaven. You know, that's the idea of just in awe of what this is. We've never seen anything like it. And it's amazing what it will be. We will enjoy the beauties. But I want you to realize the best part of heaven is not this river. The best part of heaven that we'll talk about, the tree of life or the mansion that's the addition onto his house or the streets of gold or the beauty of the pearly gates or the jasper or the amethyst and all the different jewels and things. The best part of heaven, our heart's desire, is Jesus Christ himself. And that is the ultimate beauty of heaven. This river that flows, the source of it. Look at the serenity of it. We have a river of life that is pure. It is clear as crystal. It's free of any filth. It's peaceful there. I think of Psalm 23 where he takes the sheep and he brings them by the river of waters. That peace that comes through that flowing stream. You ever gone camping or been out by the river? Or maybe you've got one, a canal, or you go out to the ocean just to listen to the waves roll in or just to listen to the river pass by and the peace that it is there, the serenity that comes in it. What this river of life will be, the purest of water, sparkling as it flows, reflecting the glory of the Lamb and bringing glory back to him as he shines in his brilliance. You want to find a blanket, sit on the grass and just watch the river go by. Okay, there's a peace that comes in it. The peace of there is no sin. The peace of this is eternity. The peace of Christ's presence. There is a peace in this river, and then the substance of the river the life of the river there. It is flowing from the throne of the giver of life. And it does remind us of the story in John chapter 4, verse 14, where he said, "But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life." That life that we have, that everlasting life that we have, free gift of salvation, that water of life. There was a day where I didn't have it and yet accepted that gift of salvation and accepted that gift of living water and get to enjoy it for all of eternity. Okay, so we see the river of life. Let's go on to, secondly, the tree of life. And look at verse 2. It says, "In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, yielded her fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations." And so we find another detail about this tree. Now, we know the origins of this tree by going back to Genesis, and we see that in the Garden of Eden, there were two trees. There was the tree of life, and there was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, God commanded, "You may eat freely of every tree of the garden. Any tree you want to eat of, go for it." There's one tree you can't eat of, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And so we see that they make the mistake. We know the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey would say. But we go into, where is this tree today? The Garden of Eden has been destroyed. They were kicked out of the garden. But we see that this tree of life is in the midst of the street, in the midst of heaven today. Now, it's an interesting tree. I want you to see the fruit of the tree, the fruits of the tree. It's not an ordinary tree. Now, I'm not a gardener. I'm not a farmer or anything like that. I have seen videos of grafting where you take one tree and you graft it into another tree. And we see some things in Romans about that where God was dealing with the nation of Israel. But this tree that deals with 12 different kinds of fruits. Now, I bought my wife a rose tree one year that had, what was it, pink and either white or red roses, and they would come out different colors, and it was beautiful. I promptly killed it. So I don't know what that says about our love. But anyway, it was different colors that came out of it. And, you know, the fruit tree that you could graft in, you could get maybe two manners, but a fruit that come off the same tree, it would be a mixture of the two as well. But you start looking at this tree that has 12 different fruits on it. Now, what kind of fruits are on this tree? It doesn't say. Could it be fruits that exist today? It could be an apple and a pear and a you know, whatever other tree that you want to put on there, whatever fruit you want to put on the tree, is, you know, plums or whatever your favorite one is. You throw oranges on there somewhere. And there's 12 different fruits that are on this tree. So as you look at it, you go, wow, it yields its fruit every month. It's an interesting statement about heaven because it mentions months. And you're going, wait a minute, how long's heaven? Well, heaven is eternal. So how do we count time? Well, we count time today by the rotation of the earth, by the sun, 24 hours, by the moon, by the month, seasons, by the year, and we see all of that. How do we count time in heaven? You know, Peter says that time is as a day is 1,000 years to the Lord, as 1,000 years is a day there. So obviously God deals with time differently than we do, but he's saying here that we have some measure of time. That there is some measure of months, whatever time that is. How long is a month? Is it 31 days? Is it 30 days? Is it 3 years? You know, how long is it? I have no clue. But we have a different manner of fruit that comes every month. If you don't like that fruit, which I'm sure you will, wait till next month. It'll be a different one. Okay, you've got 12 different fruits. Some have say has said that it's 12 fruits on the same tree, that we've got 12 different fruits on that same tree. I'm not going to, you know, split hairs over that. We're not going to split churches over this with things. It's not vital, but the tree of life is. It's in the midst of the street. It's there in the middle. It's on either side of the river, it says, and there's plenty to go around. You want to eat of the tree? Go for it. Everyone can. It's there for you to enjoy. Look down here at the passage here that says, The benefit here, and did I do that? Yeah, okay. So the benefit of the tree, look at the second half of it. It says, and I missed my place, here the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. There have been some Bible scholars that say, well, in order to stay in heaven, this is our key to it. We get to eat of the fruit, and that gives us drink of the river of water of life, and that sustains us in heaven to where we will go on throughout all eternity. I don't know that I agree with that, because then that makes heaven conditional. You know, what if I get too busy and don't eat of the fruit? Okay, what if I'm enjoying heaven so much that I did forgot to drink today? Better go get that. That makes Jesus a genie in the bottle, basically, of grant my wishes and give me this. And as long as I do that, well, that makes heaven conditional, and it's not conditional. It's unconditional based upon the Son. It's based upon my acceptance in Christ. So the healing of the nations, the word there, healing, translates to benefit. Okay? Will this fruit benefit you? Well, usually eating fruit that is natural benefits you, right? Gives you energy, it gives you strength, it gives you those things. We have eternal life. It speaks of the abundance of this life that we shall enjoy. The leaves of this tree make our eternal life more enjoyable, or it's for our benefit that it's there. Never again will we have any type of ailment, any type of pain, any type of death, sorrow, or sin. We've got all of these things that we need in Christ. And so we don't have need for any of that stuff, because that's all those things are terrible. You start talking about sin and death and curse and pain and sorrow. You know, let's get rid of all of that because we're in Christ. And these leaves here are for the benefit of the nations. So I've seen several different things on it. I just can't see that salvation is conditional based upon eating of this fruit or drinking of this water. So it is a benefit to us. But what an amazing tree this is. We don't have anything like this that exists today. Maybe it existed in the Garden of Eden that they had there, but it is there in the midst, in the middle, abounding on either side of the river, that we can enjoy this tree of life that's there. Let's look at lastly this morning, a perfect day. Look at verse 3. It says this, "And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. His servants shall serve him. They shall see his face. His name shall be in their foreheads. There shall be no night there, no candle, neither light of the sun. For the Lord God giveth them light, and they shall reign forever and ever." So as we look at this day of life, or this perfect day that we have, Hebrews 9 says this, "And as it is appointed to men once to die, but after this, the judgment." Once we die, go through the judgment of Christ, the reward that is there, the standing before God, we get to go into eternity, and we have this perfect day. The day of life will be as perfect as God intends it to be. So look at this day, the perfect day. Thank you, Tom. First of all, chapter 22, there's an absence of a curse. The curse of sin is gone. There shall be no more curse. So sin, there is no curse. There is no problem with a curse. There is no sin that happens. So I don't have to face any type of thing before. Think back to the curse. Go back to Genesis. They've fallen. What's the curse on the different aspects? Okay, we've got Adam, who's cursed, the sweat of the brow he's going to have to work with there, that it's going to be turmoil and pain. It's going to be hardship. We have the ground is cursed for his case, thorns and thistles. We have the serpent who crawls on his belly at this point, eats the dust of the ground. He's hated above all animals. Satan, we see, is cursed as well, that he's the loser in the battle in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, that the seed shall crush his head, the seed of the woman there. We look at the woman who is increased pain in childbearing, that she will also have her husband rule over her. You see all of this curse that takes place. And you start looking at it going, those are terrible things. Those are things that are caused by sin. So when we step into heaven, when we get into his presence, there is no more curse. There is no sweat of the brow. And when it says here that we shall serve him, we'll work in heaven. I'm convinced of it. Work, I believe, was part of the life before the curse, that they were to dress and to keep the garden, that they were able to do it. But it was enjoyable. It was easy. There wasn't thorns and thistles and weeds that grow faster than any grass that's there and just overtake everything. We don't have to deal with those type things of the curse. The curse is lifted. So our serving is enjoyable. Our serving is serving a perfect Savior in a perfect way. And so we have here the absence of a curse. We live in an environment that's full of the curse. And so taking that curse out, imagine what life, how enjoyable it will be. We have not only the absence of the curse, but we have the presence of God. We see in verse 4, the second half here, the Lamb shall be in it, the throne of God. They shall see his face. Remember that we see from the Old Testament, we see in the Bible, that no man has seen God face to face, that we have not been able to come before him, that anyone who did lost their life, that they could not come before the holiness and the presence of God. But at the presence of the Lamb is in it, the presence of God being here, that we shall see him to his face, we shall serve him, we shall be a part of who he is, that we have here throughout all of eternity, the intimacy of being as close to our Savior as we possibly can. I think that there are times in our life where we spend and are close with him. I think there's times in our life where we're very far from him, and we're just kind of following after our flesh and kind of following after our carnality and things that we do. There are times where I believe we feel close to his presence. Now, I'm not saying it's all about feeling, because, oh my, you can't live life on feeling. But there is a closeness with God. There is a closeness with Christ at different times where we're following his will. But for all of eternity, as close as we can be, the presence of our Savior, the presence of the Lamb, the presence of God, we shall serve him there. It says here that the name of the Lord will be in our foreheads. You're going, okay, that sounds odd and weird. What in the world that we have the name of God in our foreheads? We are sealed with him. Remember, we're sealed until the day of redemption with the Holy Spirit. We are sealed with God forever because his names are in our foreheads. Now, this is not apart from Scripture. We see some things that we have here in Scripture that can give us an indication of what this is. You go back all the way to Genesis when Cain killed Abel, that Cain was marked in his forehead with a curse that was there, that he had that mark. And people differ on what that mark was, but people knew who he was, knew not to mess with him, because if you did, you had sevenfold in your family that were killed. You go fast forward to the book of Revelation, where we have the 144,000 who are marked, who are given the seal in their foreheads, that they are Christ, that they are his. So when we get here to that we are sealed in the forehead, is this a visible mark? I have a number across my forehead, that's who I am? No, I don't believe that that's what it is, but it is, we are known of him. When Jesus starts talking in the book of John, that he knows his sheep, they hear his voice, they know him, that they are his, and he knows who are his. And so as we're looking at that, we are known of him. When we get here, we're sealed in our foreheads that we have his name. We are his, and we belong to him, and we're with him. We're not rejected. We're not part of those that were cast into the lake of fire. We're not part of those that are absent from God forever with that. We are sealed in him. His presence is there. There's no chance, okay? There's no chance that, okay, if I get there, what if I mess up when I get there? And God just rejects me and takes me away and he sends me to the lake of fire. I've been there for 1,000 years and I messed up and something happened and off I go. No. We are sealed in him. We are secure in him. We have eternity with him. That this is perfectness. So there's no chance to lose it. There's also no chance to lose it now. We can't lose it now. We can't lose it then. And so we are secure in him. We are sealed in him on that. And then we'll get to verse 5, and we'll just finish up with this, the magnificence of eternity. There should be no night there. Yeah, there's no need for night. There's no need for the sun. If you see it, there's no need for a candle, neither the light of the sun. It's dark in the house. Light a candle. Turn on a light. It's too dark in here. There is no night. There is no darkness. We see there's no need for the sun. The Lord giveth them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. And so eternity never ends. And oftentimes that's the hardest part to grasp, is how long is eternity? When will it end? We talked about this last week. Everything has an end, but eternity doesn't. So it just keeps going and going and going. It's the Energizer Bunny of of eternity. Okay, how long is eternal? How long is everlasting? It never ends, and our mind really, really can't grasp that completely. There's got to be an end. There's got to be a finish, but there is none. It says they shall reign forever and ever. Billions, trillions of years are just a moment in an eternity there. I can't imagine it. But to get to spend eternity in a perfect body, with a perfect Savior, in a perfect city, with other perfect people, sounds pretty perfect, doesn't it? If I were to live in this body for eternity, in this city, in this nation for eternity, that's not heaven. Okay? It's really not. But that's not what God's promised to us here. And when we start looking at it, that magnificence of it, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to see it. There's the time where you just listen for the trump. Did I hear it? That was a faint trump, wasn't it? Wasn't it just a little bit? You know, I'm looking for it. I hope you are too. I trust you're ready to go on that. Now I know that we've got loved ones who don't know this truth, or we've got loved ones who don't believe this truth, and we want them to go with us. And I understand that completely. Eternity is a long time, and all who have ever lived will spend it in one of two places, either eternity in heaven or eternity in the lake of fire. Would it motivate us to know all of this about heaven to be a faithful witness to those? You say, well, they've rejected it 10 times already. Well, how about an 11th time? Or how about a 12th time? Or a 13th time, or maybe I can't get to them to be in face-to-face person with them. Could I pray that the Lord sends someone to their house? That there's a faithful pastor somewhere who goes and knocks on their door? You know, that there's someone in their town that will come by and tell them about eternity? You know, there's all kinds of ways God can do things. May we be a faithful witness to it. May they know their need for a Savior and trust Christ that we can do all of this together. Okay, the great part is, I don't have to do this alone. Okay, all who are saved in eternity past, all who are saved in the time that we have and those that are here, we get to do this together. Wonderful. An amazing thing. Next week, we're going to close out the book of Revelation, and we're going to look at the finishing chapter here of the Word of God, honestly. We get down to the end of it. Behold, I come quickly. Okay, and for some of us, you're going, not quick enough. Okay, but what eternity must be, what it will be. Let's pray, we'll be done. Father, we're thankful for the day. Help us as we meditate on this truth, that we would know your goodness that you have planned for us in eternity. Help us to share it with others, our loved ones that we would love to have with us to enjoy this time together. And then, Lord, to enjoy the presence of you in all of time, all of eternity. We thank you, Lord, for teaching us. Help us to live in this and to look forward to it. We ask this in your name. Amen. All right. Have a good day, guys.